In this tutorial, I'm going to go over the information boxes, which can be found on the bottom right of the VFR sectional chart. It's got a lot of extremely important information, and I'm a bit curious as to how many people actually take the time to read what they say. So let's take a quick look and review them. If we zoom in, the first thing we'll see, it says caution, and it's in regard to GPS. And basically what it's saying is that if you're using a GPS fixed from a database, you're not going to be the only person using it. And so you better have an eye out for traffic, because there's going to be a lot of aircraft potentially converging to that GPS location. Below that, we see a comment on VFR waypoints, and it tells us all waypoints will have five letters beginning with VP. And standalone VFR waypoints are portrayed on VFR charts using the same four-point star symbol currently used for instrument flight routes, or IFR charts. VFR waypoints collected with visual checkpoints, visual reporting points, are portrayed with a checkpoint flag. VFR waypoint name is shown in parentheses adjacent to the visual checkpoint name. And then here it says, VFR waypoint names are not intended to be pronounced and shall not be used in ATC communications. That's a very subtle point, because if you see the checkpoint, the first inclination you're going to have is to tell the controller you're over Vipaxi. Well, it's not called Vipaxi. And here you can see where the Vipaxi I was referring to and the list of all of the VFR checkpoints. In fact, this is all the VFR checkpoints for this Washington sectional, and there will be different ones for each sectional that you look at, and the latitude and longitude. If we move over, we see another very important information box. It says the North American Aerospace Defense Command, NORAD procedures. All aircraft operating in the U.S. national airspace, if capable, will maintain a listening watch on guard frequencies 121.5 and 243.0. So my first question is, how many of you actually do that every flight you take? Because you're supposed to. It is incumbent upon all aviators to know and understand their responsibilities if intercepted. And if you're flying in the Washington area, you really need to know this. Review AIM, it even tells you where, section 5-6-2 for intercept procedures. Additionally, if U.S. military fighter jets intercept an aircraft, and it does happen in the DCSFRA, all and flares are dispensed in the area of that aircraft, aviators will pay strict attention. Contact air traffic control immediately on the local frequency or on VHF guard 121.5 or UHF 243.0 and follow the intercept visual ICAO signals, or International Civil Aviation Organization signals. Be advised, non-compliance may result in the use of force, and that's very, very serious. Below that chart or box, we've got the maximum elevation figure chart, and I go over that on the obstacles tutorial for sectional charts, so I won't repeat that. Here we've got another cautionary box. This chart is primarily designed for VFR navigational purposes and does not indicate the presence of all power transmission and telecommunication lines, terrain, or obstacles which may be encountered below reasonable and safe altitudes. So if you're flying very, very low, which you shouldn't be, there might be things that are not charted, and you'll fly right into it. Another box, caution, severe turbulence may occur over rugged terrain, and they tell you to see the Airman's Information Manual on that. Here's another great box, and it says, flight following services are available on request and highly recommended in and around Class B, Class C, and terminal radar service areas. And that's the airspace for the Washington area. I personally always get flight following. It's very handy. Over here, We've got information regarding U.S. Fish and Wildlife Services and U.S. forest areas, and landing of aircraft is prohibited on lands or waters that are park. It says when forced to land due to an emergency. It says that it's permissible, and it says all aircraft are required to maintain an altitude of 2,000 feet above the surface of the following: national parks, monuments, seashores, lakes, recreational areas, scenic riverways administered by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. And then they even show us here the boundary for national parks is a solid line with this dashed line, dash dot line above it. Here, if we move on, we can see that it tells us how to report chart errors. And then for procurement, contact this information over here. And then finally, we've got an information box, which is talking about Class G airspace, which extends up to 14,500 feet MSL. And then above that, it reverts to Class E airspace, excluding the airspace less than 1,500 feet above the terrain and certain special use airspace areas. And then here it's got information about VFR checkpoints by way of the flag, and I go over that also in my, I believe it's in my obstructions tutorial. And then last but not least, we've got the name of the sectional. This is the Washington sectional down here. So these are all the important information boxes. Really make sure you read them and pay attention to them, and particularly the ones for your area, because they will vary. And it's that simple.